I'd like to call to order the New Carlisle City Council meeting on Tuesday, January 9th, 2016. I'd like to remind everybody, what? What'd I say? Oh, I'm sorry, 19th, I'm sorry. Reminder, if anybody has any cell phones, please turn them on vibrate or turn them down, please. Mr. Collier, call for the roll.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Lindsay?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Here.
Mr. Crabar?
Here.
All present.
All right, now, if you'll stand, we'll have the invocation by Councilman Will McLaughlin.
Y'all stand, please. Lord, thank you for allowing us to be together this evening. Thank you for our health. Thank you for this city. City is going forward, and thank you all for all the help to be able to do that. Lord, please take care of us, guide us, help us make the right decisions, the staff and also the council. And again, God bless New Carlisle. Amen.
Amen. Now, do the pledge of allegiance from the flag in the back. Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Actions on the minutes?
Mayor?
Second.
Sorry, you can take it.
Mr. Mayor, I move that we accept the minutes of the last meeting, please. Special meeting, let's do the special meeting first, 12:30.
Second. You get the second?
Yes.
Okay.
Oh.
Any questions on minutes, council?
Excuse me, Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
We're doing 12:30.
We're doing the special, 12:30, 15.
I don't believe I can second that. I wasn't involved in that meeting.
I second it.
Craybacher second, special meeting.
What a meeting.
So changed. Any discussion? Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Abstain.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybacher?
Yes.
Pass 6-0-1.
All right, action on the minutes for the regular meeting, 1-4-16.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Ms. Craybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Pass 7-0.
Thank you, Mr. Collier. Any communications tonight?
None this evening.
All right. City manager's report, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of council, members of public. Thanks for joining us this evening. I'd like to share with you the city manager's report. For those of you who did not pick up an amended city manager's report, there's one over there. There's one slight change under two. We'll get to that in a moment. But major projects, Twin Creeks, the loan parcel did not sell at the latest sheriff's sale, which was on the 8th. The second sheriff's sale is 1-22-16. I will be present at that one at this point, but it'll be the same process as we did for the first 25 or 26 of them. Nobody bids on it. It will come back to the city, but then we have to wait, give them time to get their paperwork done as well. I do have the rest of the parcels that, the deeds that we do have for in the hands of Jake Jeffries. I met with him last week. So we're starting to get the ball rolling on that. He will be taking that on for us. But other than that, that's about the most latest I have on the Twin Creeks issues. But we'll know, have a better understanding after the 22nd in regards to that one loan parcel that did not make the first share of sale.
Thank you.
Yep, and moving on with the rules of council. I don't know if there's a slight confusion. This is the first time I've done it. I'm looking at former city manager's notes. It said must be approved of the motion. But then I saw that a resolution was passed. So what I would like to do is have them approved or make changes now, and that way we can get the resolution and in for the next one. So if there's no changes, you guys are just motion to approve them today.
So moved.
Second.
Give me a second here.
Second was by?
Mr. Enders.
Motion was by Mr. Rickover. I have a motion to adopt the rules of council. The motion by Mr. Rick Lowry, second by Mr. Reynolds. Discussion?
I have a question. Let's say something would come up where we go and we look at the rules and review it and say, hey, we really need to address this question. This is something we can do at any time throughout the year, or is it just a one-shot deal every year?
My assumption is you can probably amend it. You can amend any resolution you pass. If something comes up middle of the year, you know, you probably could with no issues, as long as majority of council.
Oh, sure.
Would like to change this as well.
Okay, thank you.
Call for vote, sir.
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Former, he could say former.
Yeah, former, yeah, that's too much.
Yes.
Mr. Kraybacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Rules of council passed 7-0.
Thank you. And moving on with the finance, our finance director, Mrs. Harris.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge, mayor, council, and members of the public. I want to present the December financial statement. So for the month of December, the total revenue that we collected was $335,352.95. Total expenses for the month of December was $617,102.43. We're starting to wrap up the end of the year, so our total revenue that we collected for 2015 is $5,071,083. We did come a little over $200,000 above our estimated budget that we believed that we were going to be collecting. On the year-to-date expenditures, we have spent $4,926,758.43, and we came under our appropriations by $461,366.65. So we've had a very good year. We've worked real hard to work on those appropriations and expenditures, and we did get a little extra income in that we didn't anticipate. So very good. Okay. On our general income tax collections for December, the general fund collected $50,727.93. The 0.5% police income tax collected for the month of December, $16,290.21. So for our year-to-date general fund income tax, we collected $1,010,061.92. And our police levy, we collected year-to-date so far $81,230.73. So total collected for the income tax with both is $1,091,292.65.
Thank you.
Any questions?
Council, any questions? Mr. McIntyre.
Yeah, I've got a question. It's really something that Ms. Harris, Kitco, and Bridge could all sort of cover. It fits in a bunch of categories, but it's kind of related to finance, so why not? I know we had kind of spoke a little bit, Randy did a bit, about having the online bill payment for the water bill. That's awesome. Do we have any more information on when something like that, we're going to start looking at the preliminary, looking at whatever, any updates?
We don't have any time frame on that, to be honest. We have all that centers around the new server that we're going to get for the finance department. So I think once we get that in place, then we'll have a better understanding of the cost it would take to do that, and then also the time frame that we can actually unroll and make it live.
So first it's the server, then it's the software packages we look at, then
sure.
Implement. Okay, so this is going to be a little bit. That's fine. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McIntyre. And Mr. Kraybacher.
Colleen, unpaid taxes. No, I haven't seen that report lately or anything. How is that doing?
I'll try to get an end of the year update. The tax clerk's been extremely busy trying to get their end of the year stuff done. So I have not received an update myself either on the collections.
Okay.
So I will try to get that for you at the next meeting.
Next meeting, I'm sorry. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Craybacher. Anyone else on council? Mr. McLaughlin.
I want to thank you again for the check registry and to point out to everyone that we are having extra duty, police extra duty, which is definitely a good thing for the city. I see there's quite a few hours that we put in this December, so that is a good thing. We've had extra people out there, which is good. Thank you for sharing that with us, if you would. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Anyone else on council?
I have one question for Ms. Harris.
Mr. Unger.
The cruiser we bought from Moorfield Township, is that paid completely now?
Yes.
Okay. And this one's directed to Mr. Bridge. Where's the cruiser at? What are we doing with it?
It's being utilized by one of our officers.
Is it? Okay. So I just wondered, I didn't know if it was put in service yet or not. Yet. Thank you.
Anyone else?
I have a question, if I may.
Mr. Collier?
Mrs. Harris, on the general fund income tax,
mm-hmm.
have we in previous years collected that amount?
No.
This seems to be excellent.
In the last...
What's the difference? I'm sorry.
Well...
Have we ever gone over a million for the general income tax?
Not the records that I've seen so far. This is our highest year. So our collections are strong, but it also depends on who's working and what their income is.
And if they're
filling them out and turning them in. Correct.
Does this mean we're doing a better job of actually collecting for some individuals? Is that what it is?
I believe so, yes.
Amazing.
I believe so.
If you look at these...
Well, that's the first time I've seen them.
Me too.
Mm-hmm. If I could jump in, Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Bridge.
If this doesn't pop out to you guys as being fantastic, I don't know what.
It's fantastic.
Yeah.
There's three numbers on there that should have jumped out. One is our over collection, the other ones are under budget, but that big one is that income tax collection. You know, maybe in years past we didn't have the right person in that position. Now that we do, you're going to see these kind of increases. But these numbers actually look great. I was very impressed with them when I got them, so hopefully everyone here in this room has seen these numbers would be just equally impressed. You have to remind yourself, a year ago, the city was going to come with $8,000.
Mm-hmm.
$8,000.
Mm-hmm.
And now we're well above that. So it's a half off to everyone sitting at this table. But we got the job done.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Colleen, you have anything else?
Councilman for the Finance Director?
Mr. Mayor.
Sir?
Okay. I didn't say anything. I do have another question. Is the city actively going after people who owe city taxes to the city? Or I know there was some talk a few months ago about it, I remember, but I hadn't really heard anything else since
then.
Yeah,
our tax administrator has been putting out a lot more of the notices about filing and penalties for for non-payment.
Mm-hmm.
Just these last few weeks, we've just been kind of focusing on end of the year. But no, she's put a lot of effort in the collections and just keeping better records and getting things posted. And I think the verbiage all year has been a lot about the income tax, and that's helping to get people who haven't filed, you know, back on track.
Okay.
Can I add to that?
Yes, sir.
I do believe there's a three-letter process that she goes through. Legal action taken. In years past, we haven't issued that three-step mm-hmm. process. But again, you're seeing the results of that being implemented.
Would there be legal action taken if they didn't reply to the third letter?
I would do. It'd be a cost-benefit analysis.
Well, it depends on how much they would owe.
Sure.
I mean, if they owe $20,
no, we're not going to go after that. Our attorney fees will cover that in 10 minutes.
10? That long? Wow.
So.
No, that's all I have. Thank you,
Mr. Lindsay. Anyone else on council?
Yes.
Mr. Craybacher.
It's just a guess, you know, so you know, the people that you have contacted that have back taxes are probably paying their taxes now. And so that's probably the increase that's just going to be my guess. Because, you know, there was a time there with New Carlisle, was called the no tax city, but now they know.
I think it could be a mixture of that. I think it could be a mixture of people maybe having a better job, maybe, you know, going on and instead of making $28,000 a year, they're making a little bit more than that. But I think as a direct result of putting the position, the person in the position that we have in.
Okay. I have one more question. I just received my tax form in the mail, and I assume everybody else did. You know, it's a nice envelope and everything. But has anybody complained about the tax forms being so much different than it was previously?
I haven't heard of any complaints, but we've gotten a few calls with questions, and the tax administrator's been walking through for anybody that it's been different for. But I haven't, she hasn't relayed any messages about any complaints on it.
I haven't heard a complaint.
But I do believe those are state mandated changes too.
Are they?
Yeah, especially when it comes to the forms and all that. She had to go back there and literally redo all the forms we had. Hmm. So it's not something we just did on our own. A while ago, the council had passed changes pertaining to tax, to our tax. So I think that was part of that as well.
Okay.
Ms. Harris, so even though those changes may not be directed from us, the citizens can still openly call the office and get help with that?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Mr. Bridge.
Thank you, Ms. Harris. Moving on with our discussion, our service director, Mr. Kitko.
Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Good evening, Mayor, Council, members of the public. Just a couple quick items. A decorative light was hit in front of Lee's Famous Recipe Chicken. I've been in contact with the insurance company of the driver. They've already admitted liability and we'll be covering that. We will be getting that done as soon as probably weather permits and get our estimates up to them. We will be applying for a CDBG this year for fiscal year 2017 to try and see what we get dollar-wise. That has been going down for years now, so not looking for the best or large amount, but we'll see what we can get. You'll see in Edgebrook an ordinance tonight in your packet to start working on some more street projects. This winter, we're going to work on some odds and end items for the street crew and cemetery and some things we couldn't get completed during the summer. So that is all I have. I can entertain any questions about any services.
Council. Mr. McLaughlin.
I just have a comment. I noticed down by Water Dog on 235 Main Street, put a patch in about what it's been giving us a lot of problems. Thank you for that. I've had people say it'd be nice not to hit that hole and you've got a patch, so thank you.
Just an update on that. That will be a constant headache for us. So we're looking at this spring is, there's an overlay coming, but this isn't an overlay of thicker asphalt, it's just micro-surfacing. So what we're gonna do is probably take the two travel lanes that you see that are busting up and we're gonna replace that with concrete this spring. We're responsible for any major road repairs to the state routes. So we'll be taking care of that this spring also.
Council, any other questions? Mr. Reynolds.
Because we're responsible for major road repairs, do we actively seek to see if there's minor repairs that we can say, hey, this is a state route, you ODOT, let's handle it.
The only time that they will fund anything is during the urban revitalization program, and that's where they cover 80%, we pay the 20. But we get the gas tax and everything that comes with the state route being inside the city, so we're already being paid. They funnel that money down into our state highway fund for that purpose. If there's anything extra, I could look into it, but usually they won't. That kind of like, you're looking like a grant or something, this is?
Well, I didn't know if they would, because you said like they would take care of it, I didn't know if they actually came out. Like if we saw it and said, hey, this is a problem, and called them up and they'd be like, oh, we're on it, instead of us taking care of it.
Maybe there's something I'm unaware, but they already funneled the money from their state funds to us for that.
Yeah. All right, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jones. Mr. Kerbaugh.
On the contract that you're talking about the resurfacing, it states that. So after the resurfacing, we're responsible for anything within the city limits.
Yeah, in particular one coming in front of you tonight, we do not have a contribution to that one. But for the full urban revitalization one where they actually mill off asphalt and add asphalt is the one where we usually cover the 20%.
Okay. Mr. Kick, I had a question on Edgebrook. That's going to be a basic mill and fill or an overlay?
That is a minor mill, sort of what I call a scratch, okay, and overlay with approximately 10%. Well, I got about 1,200 linear feet of curb and gutter to be replaced.
Is it going to be hit and miss curbs and gutters? Which ones are the worst?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Council.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Kiko, the money you was talking about that comes from the state highway fund, does that go into our road fund then? Or where does that money go?
That's a separate state highway fund in your budget that those funds go to. We use that fund where it's salt road repairs for state highways only.
Strictly for like 571 and 235?
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
I did have one more for you. I don't know if you guys noticed the decorative lighting right there at the corner of Studebaker's, right across from the back of AutoZone with the trucks back in. It's leaning. I don't know if you guys knew it had been bumped.
No, I didn't know anything about it. So yeah, I just got, are you saying it probably got hit again?
Yeah, I'd assume it got grazed.
Where is it at in relation to AutoZone? Is it their truck coming in and out? Are they docking?
Well, they don't use that actual dock, but they dock, they pull into that back alley between Marathon and the back of AutoZone. So they put that the nose of the truck right up against that curb and that lighting that's right there. It's been hit numerous times, hasn't it?
It's been hit a couple of times, but so is Studebaker's. They pulled a tractor up on it, hit actually Studebaker's roof line before a lot of times.
Jeez. All right.
I will look into that.
Thank you. Mr. Bridge.
Thank you. And moving on with our planning and zoning discussion. I'm going to have Mr. Kitko give a quick update of the Van Caress debut construction up there. But just in case anyone did notice, Friday I did field a few phone calls in relation to that construction project. Addison New Carlisle Road was pretty covered in mud pretty bad. So we did receive a series of about 5 or 6 phone calls. I immediately called up Van Caress and they told me the problem. So hopefully it will not persist. But they do have to scrape that road above mud a few times if they're bringing it all in, especially in the construction site. I think it happened just because of the snow we had and then the melting because it got almost, what, 40 degrees or 50 mm-hmm. that next day. So I think that has a lot to do with it. But for general update, Mr. Kitko?
But thank you. No, I did that. I also asked them to bring a broom out last Friday, I think. So Van Crest is moving pretty quickly. A little bit of the frigid temperatures have slowed a little bit of their concrete work, but they have their new sewer installed. Their new water line, suppressed fire line is installed, and their service line, which will be their second domestic line into their main building, is installed, and I think the state has seen the pressure test on it. So weather is what's gonna keep them from really their concrete work right now. But they're moving as quick as they can.
Well, they move, I mean, they're on their schedule as far as where they're at?
I don't know much about their schedule as far as where they went with, like their ribbon cutting is, so I'm not really sure.
Okay, thank you. Council, any questions?
Since we're talking about Bayview, hookup fees for the water and sewer. So are they paying the normal price, or are they paying a reduced price, or how's that coming about?
There is an agreement from the mid-90s concerning their tap fees. Anytime you can come in, it's really thick. But it has to do with when they expanded water service to them back in the mid-90s on some of their tap fees automatically get waived.
Oh, it gets waived?
Yes. Okay.
Thanks, sir. Appreciate it.
And moving on with the planning and zoning discussion, just an update on Speedway. The east side store will be closing on 212, which is February 12th, 2016. Don't have any other answer than they're closing it. That's what I got, I'm assuming, because the other one's doing fantastically well, that they're not going to want to fund both of those. So it's an unfortunate, but it is certain that it will be closing in February.
I mean, the new Speedway is nonstop. I mean, it's got a line, I think, inside every time you drive by.
It's doing very well.
Mr. Lindsay.
The new Speedway, the reason they're always jam-packed because they're giving you a dime off of the regular price. I filled up tonight at $1.55, you know, sign said $1.65 something, you know. On the Speedway that's closing, Mr. Bridge, is there any word what they're going to do with that? They're going to level it, clean it up, abandon it?
We will be the last to know what they're going to do with that building. Yeah. I hate to say it like that, but that's usually how it works. It's not until they file either a planning board or a zoning permit application that we know what's going on. Sometimes I get a little hint if somebody calls and say, hey, what's the zoning on this parcel? But anything going in that spot is going to have somebody already looking at that and knowing what they're doing.
Does Speedway own that corner, or are they leasing it or something?
No, I'm pretty sure they own it.
I think they own it.
And it's a unique parcel because it's a corner lot, so I know everybody's thinking Taco Bell.
Yeah.
Sorry on that one too.
Steakhouse.
Taco Bell has told me specifically they want to be close to 70. What's unique with that current Eastside Speedway lot is if you go in the back, it's actually, there's a drop off down in the alley. So whoever's going to go, if they want to redevelop that parcel, is going to have to, one, vacate the alley. They don't have to level out all that land. So I'm anxious but yet nervous to see what's going to happen, to be quite honest. My concern was it'd be a discount smoking store, because a lot of those old speedways get sold to like a Smokes for Less. But Smokes for Less, from talking to a Speedway manager, was actually owned by Speedway, but Speedway no longer owns that. So it's not as easy for them just to switch it out to a Smokes for Less. Right. So it's up in the air.
I would imagine my personal, I'm sorry, Mr.
I just was confirming his comment.
I would imagine that if they wouldn't want another gas station, I mean, it's just an opinion, that they would pull the tanks on the building.
Yeah, they're not going to sell it to another gas station.
Because, they don't want to leave it as an open possibility for a competing gas station.
Mm-hmm. I would like for them to wait to see when the 10 cent rolls off, how busy the other one stays, because I guarantee once that 10 cent roll off goes off, they're in a good position. They get the northbound and southbound traffic. Mm-hmm. And I think once they close that one on the east side, they're going to realize maybe we shouldn't have done that. Because in the spring and summer, when people are coming up here through boats going to the lakes, it's a perfect scenario for them.
Yeah. I think the Marathon station will get a little busier.
And mine?
When they shut it down.
Yeah. Sure. Yep.
Any other questions from council? Bridge, carry on. Please.
Sure. And moving on, our fire discussion with our fire chief, Mr. Chief Trusty. This is the fun part of being a chief. Tonight I'd like to recognize, after three of our firefighters that one was not here due to his work schedule with being a full-time firefighter in Springfield, City of Springfield. Tonight is to recognize Diana Gosman and Darren Stutzel and Anthony Cooper, all three are being promoted to the rank of captain, effective already. Diana Gosman is promoted to the rank of captain. She's now our EMS captain. Her duties are running the EMS training program for the department, protocol testing, which is done each year, and also scheduling of the part-time program and monitoring the training. Diane is a firefighter, paramedic, LPN. She's been with the division over 10 years. And so she has a lot of experience, a lot of time with the program, a lot of time with fire service, but she's with also Bethel Clark prior to being with us. Darren Stitzel is promoted to the rank of captain. He is our fire training captain. Darren is a firefighter EMT. He's also a certified state fire instructor, has several different certifications through the fire service. He's been with the division for over 14 years. Anthony Cooper is not here, but he's promoted to the rank of captain. He is now the Elizabeth Township Station captain, who reports directly to Chief Ritter. Tony's been with the division also over 11 years. So if you looked at these three captains and their time in fire service, there's almost 50 years of experience. There's 35 years of experience in New Carlisle. It makes it really easy to promote people. And this is where I was talking about before, that there's a lot of untapped talent and knowledge and experience already in the division. All you got to do is ask. All three of these promotions were hands down, easy picks, easy promotions. And it was done in a systematic way. Each one, the two captains and the training captain, they submitted the resume, submitted to the department, and it was interviewed and checked by the two assistant chiefs. They made their recommendations. Captain Gosman was promoted as an administrative captain. Her position was basically she has the credentials. No one else has them in the department. Again, easy pick and easy promotion for all three of them. And I have no doubt that the divisions will continue to grow and continue to do great with this type of leadership and officer ranks. So. Congratulations.
Congratulations, guys. Thank you. We appreciate all you guys' hard work. Diane, I tell you, it seems like every time I step out of the house or into the fire department, you're always there. It's, I wonder if you have an actual house or not.
I do. I live down the street.
We only let her go home at certain times.
Okay, well, that's good. Thank you.
As far as our other report for the month of December, New Carlisle Fire Division responded to 104 EMS calls, 11 EMS calls in Elizabeth Township. The division responded to 17 fire-related calls in the city and 9 fire-related calls in Elizabeth Township. 4 EMS calls were answered by either Pike Township or Bethel Clark due to our medic already being on a response. In the month of December, all the newer employees that were brought on prior to December have already completed all the orientation and are assigned to the part-time program. We have one employee that was brought on in December, which will be through their orientation by the end of January and brought on as part-time. We're still moving forward with the compressor and cascade system to get it moved and installed into the station. We've applied for 2 different grants, one for the city, one for the Elizabeth Township. Those grants can take up to 2 to 4 months for us to hear anything back, whether or not we receive them or not. But we're still looking at monies, trying to raise money by grant. It's a lot easier, a lot easier to do if we get them. Makes our jobs a lot easier, but it's one of those things we'll wait and see right now.
Thank you, sir. Any questions for council? Mr. Lowry.
Yes, thank you. Elizabeth Township contract.
Elizabeth Township contract has not been signed as of yet. They just got their new trustee on board this month, and at the meeting he had not seen the contract or read the contract, was not familiar enough with it, where he could voice to it, and we're meeting with them again this month.
Thank you.
Mr. Bridge.
And I have voiced my concerns with chief trustee that they are to sign it sooner than later. We can't drag our feet on it anymore. We've involved them every step of the way during the turmoil and during the hiring. There's no reason other than respecting their new trustee and letting him time to analyze it and understand it, but we can't have it go on longer.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
I agree.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Chief, how many active people do we have in the fire department?
We have active duty right now. We have 54 on the roll. We have 2 trainees.
Thank you.
Mr. Lindsay.
I had a couple of questions. First, congratulations to the new captains. I'm sure you'll do great things in your new position. Next question's for the chief. Was they lieutenants prior to be promoting to captains?
One was a lieutenant. Captain Geiselman was a lieutenant prior to. The other two were firefighters.
Okay. The grant money you was talking about, if I may, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Continue.
The what are you planning on using that grant money for if you acquire the grants?
One grant that we have applied for, it will be for bunker gear and/or cascade system and air compressor. We've got one that was given to us.
Okay.
But if we can get one on a grant, we would do the same thing that prior fire department did for us. We would pass it down to another fire department that was in need of one.
Okay.
That way. The other grant is for the March radio system.
Okay. What department donated the cascade system and the compressor?
Chief. Christianburg.
Christianburg?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. It's very nice. Those are expensive.
Yeah,
quite expensive.
Yes, they are.
I assume you wrote a letter or somebody from the city wrote a letter thanking them a lot. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Chief Trustee, what about any updates on letters of interest or applications and hiring?
Excuse me?
Any interest, new applications, job applications for the fire department?
Yeah, we're still receiving applications. We're still receiving phone calls asking if, part-time paid and paid for call. And we're accepting any and all applications and putting them through the hiring process or looking at them.
Good.
The biggest thing we have right now is we have to be able to outfit the people that we bring on.
Correct.
And we're in the midst of, with the new budget year and everything, of looking of ordering and buying gear. But that's a 3-month or more process to do that, to have the gear sized and made.
Thank you very much. Mr. Bridge?
Sure. And moving on with our police discussion, our favorite stranger, Sergeant Underwood.
Yay! Thank you.
Welcome back.
I'll be back to some smiling faces. Stick to that. Last time I was here,
I didn't see that many faces that happened, so. Anyhow, thank you, City Manager, Mayor, Council, and citizens. Our police report for New Carlisle tonight is reports taken by New Carlisle deputies. There were 16. Reports by a county deputy, 29. And that was a total of 45 reports taken for the city. Under miles patrolled, we had 1,507. Miscellaneous calls, there were 90. And follow-up investigations, we had 5. Under traffic information, traffic stops, there were 53. Citations issued, 16. OVI arrest, 2, with 2 charges. Driving under suspension, 5. Parking citations, we had 4. Abandoned vehicles towed, there was none. And that's amazing this time of year. Non-injury accidents were 2, and injury accidents that were 1. And I want to point out again, that would have been just the crashes taken by the sheriff's office or the deputies in New Carlisle. Under arrest information, criminal adult arrests, we had 4. Criminal adult charges, there were 3. Criminal juvenile arrest, there was none. And of course, there were no charges. Warrant arrest filed was 1. And warrants filed, we didn't have any in December. Under special interest, assaults, there were none. Breaking, entering, we had 1. Thefts, there were 2. Vandalism, none. 911 hangups, there were 8. Phone harassment, we had none. Domestic violence with an assault, we had 1. And domestic violence verbal, we had 0. And that is absolutely great this time of year. Usually you see those numbers up quite higher than that. Lockouts, 3. Peace officer calls, we had 3. Alarms, 3. And we had 15 assists. And a little memo I have here, it's great news to hear we're going to get another deputy to bring the total up to 4 deputies. Miko Lyons will be the 3rd deputy, and she will have completed her field training within the next few weeks. And I expect that to be maybe a little sooner than that. As soon as she completes her training, she will be moved to New Carlisle, and we'll have additional training with the New Carlisle deputy. And a 4th deputy will be added as soon as possible. I found out today who that 4th deputy will be. His name is Jeff Boswell. He's worked in the jail as a jailer for, I'm going to take a wild guess, about 5 years. And he will go through the training that Deputy Lyons is going through, and then he will be assigned out here. And just as a reminder, just before the snow, we had several complaints of speeders, especially on Pike Street. So deputies are patrolling that area, and they are writing citations. And the weather has slowed that down some. I'm sure as weather clears up, we'll have those continuing people speeding. And I'm hearing it's mostly employees going to work or coming home from work. So please be careful. You don't need a citation this time of year. That concludes my report, and if I have any questions, I would be happy to try to answer them.
Mr. Roach.
Sir, I had a resident ask me a question about some of the services the Sheriff's Department provides. What I like about the Sheriff's Department, one of the great things is that all the different benefits that we get that go into it. Anyway, they were wondering about canine units, specifically what a canine unit does, and when in New Carlisle would we have a canine unit happen to visit, and what they would do. If you have any insight on that, I know I'm springing something on you.
No, the canine's been up here numerous times. traffic stops, school searches. It's just not been publicized much, but the canine unit works every night, and even if it's across the county and the deputy up here needs the canine, they can request it, and most of the time the canine will respond. So that's whenever the canine's working, we have access to it.
Okay, so it's not uncommon then for us to have a canine here in town doing the various actions it does.
Absolutely, that does happen.
Thank you.
It's to piggyback off Bill, so it is one of our perks per se that if we need it, it's there.
It's there, and if we need it, and our dog at the sheriff's office isn't working, we have access to a few other agencies that will bring a dog in also. So, actually, we have access to Wright Path and
the airport. The airport's thinking about bringing in canines for us.
Thanks, sir. Council?
Sir.
Mr. Lindsay?
Sergeant Underwood, glad to see you. Hope it's
Thank
a
you.
Regular appointment with us.
I'm sure it will be.
The on the dogs, do we have access to like drug sniffing dogs? If somebody stops a car and they suspect drugs in the vehicle, do we have a dog
Yes, that's
access?
The dog I was just speaking about.
Okay. Does it also sniff out bombs?
No.
So that's Wright Pat's dog?
That's Wright Pat's dog or the airport's dog.
Okay.
And they're very qualified. That's what they do all day.
Right. On the new deputy, Boswell, can you give us any more of his experience besides being in the jail for 5 years?
At this time, I cannot. That was just released late this afternoon. And it was more around noontime, actually. And that's what I know currently. So I'll find out what I can and pass it on.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
The sheriff usually sends me a profile of the deputy with their experience and their background, and usually a picture.
Okay.
As soon as I get that, I'll order it off the council.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Sergeant Underwood, how are the other two deputies doing, the ones that have been here for a while?
Fantastic. They're being involved with the community. They've went above what they should do on several calls with our senior citizens. They're doing what they need to do.
Chief. Speaking of the two new deputies that's already on, as far as the fire division, we couldn't ask for anything better. They're there. They don't, a lot of times we'll go on calls, if they're not respond or dispatched along with us, they'll see the medic go by, they'll just trail behind. Just as, hey, you guys need something, you okay?
Yes.
Just to help out. We had one medic call, deputy called back and up in the back of the medic with us, helped out, did whatever they can do for us. And with the location of the house next to the division, we've kind of adopted them as family, and we had them come up to the Christmas party, to the Christmas dinner, and sit down and eat with us. And we could not ask for a better working relationship. And when Sergeant's talking about going above and beyond, both of them, I've seen them several times, went above and beyond what they really needed to do or had to do.
It sounds like, I've seen a few people say it online and stuff, that, you know, when they had stopped and showed up at that little boy's house and, you know, wished him Merry Christmas and whatnot, that a lot of people said they haven't seen that type of relationship in New Carlisle for a long time. And it's nice that we can try and get that back and bring that, you know, that whole personal hometown feel back. So that's great. Council, anybody else?
One more, Sergeant. Just wanted to welcome you back. You've done an outstanding job for us, and I'm glad to see you back.
It's a pleasure to be back. Thank you, sir.
Mr. Bridge.
Mr. Mayor, I have one more question, if I may.
Mr. Lindsay.
It's directed to the sergeant and chief over there. The when you guys are dispatched on a medic run, does the sheriff department, our officers, also know what that run is?
Not unless it deems a law enforcement need, then they're dispatched and given the same information we have.
And who makes that determination? Your dispatchers?
Depends on what the call is. If it has anything to do with a domestic or anything, the sheriff's department notified. Right, matter of fact, they're usually notified before us. A lot of times they're already on scene.
Okay. I was just wondering if they routinely would show up on calls or not. If nothing else, just to watch your back while you're doing what you're doing.
Well, that's what I'm saying. A lot of times it's just the fact that they see us going out the door or they see us responding and they'll pick up and come behind us.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I actually have one question.
Mr. Reynolds?
Sergeant Edward, you can respond.
Yes, they have capability of scanning the channels too. So the radios we have in the cars will scan the frequency. So if they're not busy, just about every call that the squad's on or the fire department, they will be there.
Okay. Drive by and see what's happening. Okay, thank you.
Mr. Reynolds.
Sergeant Edward, with the Suzanne Hopper Act passed, has that been utilized yet in New Carlisle to warn first responders that if someone were to have a mental health issue, have we had to use that yet?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the first part of the question.
The Susanna Hopper Act has went into play, signed up that we have, has that information, have we had to use that yet?
I'm not sure in this area. We have used this in other areas of the county, but I'm taking a guess. I don't believe so in New Carlisle at the time.
Which is good.
Yes. So.
But I just want to make sure that if it's able to be utilized, then we can dispatch out to us. Good deal. Thank you.
Council, anyone else? Thanks, Sergeant.
Thank you, Bridge.
And moving on with the city manager's report, just go over some informational items. Trash bags are now being sold at Marathon Gas Station. They are no longer sold at the city building. Moving those would it was a real inconvenience for some of our residents who either go to work early in the morning or get off later in the night. If they can't fit that 8 to 5 time frame, then they weren't getting trash back. You know, so having a Marathon expands the hours that our citizens can go get, and it also gives a local business extra chance to make a good bucks there as well when people go in and get the trash back. So definitely a win-win for everybody on that one. Next round of union negotiations for our city's employees is January 26, 2016. I'm not sure if we'll sign the agreement at that day or not, but as soon as we'll be signing, it will be pushed on to the rules and council to pass the ordinance. The next item on there is the council needs to set its date for the yearly town hall meeting. I am requesting this date be no sooner than after March 1st, and this will allow us time to actually close out the year. The charter just requires it to be once a year. It doesn't mandate a date. I know in years past it was done in February. However, the year is not closed in February, so you're not really getting a true overall report of the year.
So anytime after March?
Anytime after March would be great.
After March or during March?
After March. It could be after anytime after March. That includes March or anytime after March.
As I noted, the two meetings in March are the 7th and the
7th. Another request is I would prefer to have it on the second one of the month. That way everybody's here and they don't have to come to the next one if they don't need to come in.
That'd be the 21st.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lowry.
Motion to have the town hall meeting on March, did you say
21st.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Reynolds.
You sound much different today. I
apologize. Sounds sick.
Yeah,
indeed.
I have a question.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Are we going to start earlier and have it first, or are we going to have the council meeting first and then the town meeting?
I think the format should probably stay the same. How was it done before first?
Started
at 6:30.
At the last month. First meeting of the month, so we didn't have a lot to do.
Right.
It was the way it usually was, and right. Started half an hour early.
Right. I mean, I can make it heavy or light or whatever with month. If I need to put more ordinance on for the first, I mean, I have some leeway with that. Yeah.
So we're going to have a council meeting first, and then have you.
Whatever the format was in years past is fine. I just don't want it on February
1st.
I know it started at 6:30.
Then we can talk to the citizens.
So it'd be 6:30 council and then 7 o'clock town hall.
That's the way we've done it in the past.
Is that okay with the council? Mr. Lindsay?
Will this be advertised in some form, Mr. Bridge?
It will be advertised in a legal paper.
And just the legal notices?
Okay. Can that be... That's a good idea. Could it be put on the water bill by chance, or does it get put on the water bill?
I can see, yeah. If it's feasible,
I think more that people sees it, they may show up with questions. If you just put the legal notices in there, you know, most legal notices are real boring. Nobody reads them. I'm probably the only one that does. don't have nothing else to do. Do what, sir?
And apparently nobody reads the water bills either, but
I didn't know it was due.
Okay.
All right, so is everyone good to move forward with the
15th and 16th?
Can we have a motion? Do we have to, what the motion's actually?
Let me summarize how I would write this motion up. A motion to conduct the annual town hall meeting on 3/21/16. With the council meeting to begin at 6:30, town hall meeting immediately after that meeting.
Immediately after.
Very good. With the second by
Mr. Reynolds.
You okay with that motion?
Totally fine.
Gotcha.
Very inclusive.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybrocker?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Pass 7-0. And what I'll do for the next meetings that are coming up is I'll make sure I put that down on the business and continue to hammer home with that.
Great.
How we're going to do that.
Thank you. Mr. Bridge?
And moving on, in the package you might see this Ohio Safe Room rebate. Basically, this is a, if you want to build a tornado shelter, essentially, you can apply to get 75% of the cost reimbursed up to a maximum of $5,250. So, if you're in a market to build a safe shelter, now's the time to do it. The deadline to apply is February 10th of 2016, so it's right around the corner. So these are in the packets. I'll make some copies and put them in the city building just in case anyone wants to stop in and maybe pick up some, but I think it's a good deal.
Is that for the whole state?
Yes, it's from the house.
Yep.
And then the other thing on here is active shooter training program. I sent an email to Sheriff Kelly a month or so ago. Just what would happen if God forbid somebody came into the city building or came in here and opened fire. We have no plan in place.
Hopefully he goes after the deputy first to give us time to get out to get our guns.
So my thoughts on this is I don't think we should do training because there's no one here that can carry a firearm into the city building or into the shelter house. So I think that we should probably just look at getting a plan done. I'll be reaching back out to the sheriff. I just wanted the sheriff council what my intentions are with that. But we definitely need to have them in place that each one of our facilities, our water plant, our wastewater plant, what happens if somebody comes in and just does that?
Mm-hmm.
You know. So moving forward, I think it's something that we probably should have in place.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Holmes.
Oh, can I cut you off?
Yeah, go ahead.
Your statement that we can't carry anywhere, that can be resolved with an ordinance to allow firearms in the city buildings. That can be done locally. It can supersede the state law, I believe. Am I correct or not? I mean, I will do more research on it, but I think an ordinance can fix that. Then we, then we can have active shooter training.
I'm pretty sure that's, is that a federal law?
No, it's state. It's under the Ohio Revised Code.
I don't know the number off my head. That as well.
It's the Ohio Revised Code.
Right,
that can
but if
be
the federal government states that it can't be in any sort of buildings like that. I'll be honest with you, I don't think they should be allowed inside buildings, especially the city. I don't think they should be allowed inside here either, unless you are a police officer. That's my personal opinion.
Anything else, sir?
No, it's like talking to
Mr. McIntyre.
Sergeant, I'm going to put you on the spot here. For active shooters, there's three things that people can do that they should always remember if an active shooter happens. You know, it used to be you catch on fire, you stop, drop, and roll. For active shooters, there's three things. Can you name those for the public, please?
Can I name the three things for it?
Yeah, that's what you're supposed to do.
Dodge.
That is very specific, and I won't right. even get
Homeland Security, Department of Homeland Security says you run, you hide, or you fight back. So when you take anyone who hasn't had active shooter training at their work, the three things they say to do are try to run, get away. If you can't get away, hide, take cover. That's get behind something that is at least bullet resistant or would slow down in some way. And if you can't do that, fight back with whatever you have. Because even if you throw a stapler at him, it's going to catch him off guard. So that's what Homeland Security recommends,
right.
Just for the people.
The
a couple of my guys actually teach the training, and they've been to extensive classes. It's a training that will teach you a lot, but you will also have very valuable information, and it's well worth it if we can get it up here. The schools are a little different. We teach the staff a little different than we do the kids, but no longer do we have the kids hide to be executed, and that's kind of what it was.
Thanks, Sergeant. Council, any other questions? Mr. Bridge.
That is all I have for the city manager report.
Thank you, sir.
Any questions
for the city manager before we move on? Resolutions. None tonight? I'm getting there. Comments from, now it's time for comments from the members of the public. Anyone in the audience? Mr. Cobb?
Ronald Cobb, 202 Villa Drive. I want to direct my comment to the chief here, fire chief.
Yes, sir.
What is Battalion 52 paid when he responds?
He's paid whatever his hourly wage is to be, whatever his certification is.
When he responds to Elizabeth Township, who pays for that?
That's under Elizabeth Township contract.
Pardon?
That's under the Elizabeth Township contract as far as paying for that salary. It depends on what the run is, though, if it's a mutual aid. If he responds to Elizabeth Township, that's considered a mutual aid run.
Okay, now, the Battalion 52, in my opinion, is a waste of money. Battalion 52, this past 2 weeks ago, was responding over here on Fenwick. He was there 30 seconds. En route, there was a second call on North Church. He was at the Fenwick Drive 30 seconds to that, responded to North Church. The medic hadn't reached Fenwick yet. So how can Battalion 52 make that decision in 30 seconds to go to the second run?
Did he have radio communications with the medic?
Pardon?
Did he have radio communications with the medic?
I didn't hear no communication between him and the medic.
He may have. I can't speak to the call because I'm not familiar with the exact call. He may have had radio communications with the medic and told the medic to go ahead and take that call, and he would respond to the medic.
Now, like I say, your Battalion 52 is a waste of the citizens' money, and I'm going to pursue this. We've got to stop wasting money.
I agree, sir. I don't feel that the Battalion is a waste of money.
99% of the time, Battalion 52 does not make a removal.
No, the Battalion 52 is not going to do the removal. The medic does the removal.
But that's the waste of the citizens' money when a person just responds and does nothing.
Not always, sir. It's always that he's not doing nothing.
Well, you know, it is. He's being paid just to go sit there with his thumb, winging around.
He assists the medical. He's also in charge, if they have a fire run, he's also the officer in charge of that fire run at the time unless one of the three chiefs show up on scene and takes command from them.
But you're missing the point here. We're wasting citizens' money by paying somebody to run and do nothing.
It'd be no different than if that person was sitting at home, we had a response, and they respond to it from their home, they're still going to be paid. This way he's in the house.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, I'm going to pursue it farther, and I'll do whatever I have to do.
Can I
Mr. Bridge?
Sir? Mr. Cobb? Your thought about maybe offering solutions how to help the problem?
I can't hear you.
Can you help us out with the problem instead of creating them? I've heard a rumor that you're going to try to get our fire and EMS levy removed or recalled. Can you speak any truth to that?
I'll take part of it away from them so they've got to tighten their budget up.
So you're going to put 6,000 people lives at risk over...
The people are upset with this in the town.
Point one, point two is there's a term called sunken costs, and I probably should look into it. We budget these salaries out for the year. We already have money allocated for that. Any one of these people to be wherever they need to be, wherever this chief sees fit for the year. You know, I think that you tend to split hairs a lot, and I think that maybe you should come to us and be like, all right, this is how do we fix this instead of threatening to recall 11. That boggles my mind.
I've tried to come to you on a couple of incidents involving the Battalion 52. You ignored them.
Why would you want to recall a levy for fire and EMS?
Well, I'm going to do whatever has to be done.
A police levy for public safety. I understand your concerns, but your remedies have made no sense. None whatsoever.
Well, if you make them tighten their budget up, it will make them.
The fire department's operating fantastically right now, and I'm sorry that you don't agree with one aspect of its operations, but we are not going to put in danger 6,000 people, even more, that we respond to in the region because you don't like something that he does.
I'm not the only one that doesn't like it.
Well, you're the only one that we ever hear from.
Well, I'll do what has to be done.
Sure.
Thank you, Mr. Cobb. Nancy, to the podium, please. Name?
Good evening. My name's Nancy Levanovich, 505 Pease Drive. Can you hear me, Mike?
I hear you.
Okay.
Good job.
I have a couple of concerns. One was the, and I didn't even know about it, the dog. Are we covered under insurance in case something happens with the dog? If he, I mean, seeing how he's not coming on a regular basis was my understanding.
You talking about the canine unit?
Yeah.
Yes, ma'am, we have.
Yeah, so you were paying for insurance for him whether he's there or not.
Well, not the city of New Carlisle, the Clark County Sheriff's Office.
Okay.
New Carlisle does not pay any insurance for that dog.
Good. Glad to hear it. And the other thing was, I'm reading in the paper about these things that we're doing that sound great. I'm kind of concerned as to where the money's coming from now, because we didn't have any at the end of the year. We're like going to update the
computer server. So if you're talking about
right,
the servers.
There's a couple of things that they had in the paper with the moving into the new place that they want to move into, you guys want to move into. And I just wonder where that money's coming from when we didn't have any at the end of the year.
It's a mixture of reduction of staff, reduction of cost, reduction of staff, reduction of things that we purchased. If you read the article that was in the Springfield News Sun in regards to that CIP, 2016 was a very logical explanation. I mean, it's a logical, trying to get my words together here. The 2016 CIP was what we're actually going to get that we can't afford. Anything past 2016 was quote unquote a wish list. So if you're referring to maybe a street building being bought, paid, built for $100,000, that was on that CIP and included in that article, probably not going to happen. Now, that being said, when we did this year's CIP, we actually looked down and we looked at our budget, see what we actually could work with. You know, money for Bell Manor is going to be saved over the course of 2 or 3 years. You know, we still got some discussion we have to do before we finalize our tax budget.
That's the other thing, Randy. What kind of, not experiment, what kind of research have you done into, like, the building there? I know you told me that it was up to date and stuff, but you were going to have to do some stuff. But the money that I saw in the paper didn't look like a large amount of money to update, and having a house, I could have spent that on one room. So I'm just kind of concerned that maybe it's going to end up more than what you think, that kind of thing down the line.
I think, again, that this discussion is a little premature. I think you have valid concerns, but I think that once we start talking about our final budget for 2016, then we'll probably have better answers for you.
Okay.
Sure.
All right. Keep me informed.
Will do.
Thank you.
Nancy, also, I know one of the things in that article you were talking about, Randy, do you mind touching on the, it was in the paper also, a possible very minor, small kitchen for this, where the funds were coming from that. Can you go over that?
Yeah, so we're getting a $5,000. I applied for a $5,000. I already applied. Just wrote a letter to the county commissioner seeking $5,000 for our park services. We got that. And then we're also getting reimbursed on, we allocated additional $5,000 just out of money from the city that we have. So we budgeted $10,000 total. $5,000 is actually money that we're going to be paying for, and the other one is money from the commissioners.
You understand what I'm concerned?
Sure. But you're looking at a project that the city got 50% funded.
I know, it's like right hand, left hand, but.
This right here is a moneymaker for us. You know, people rent this out. It's probably booked a year in advance, you know. So
I hope so.
You know, if you don't make improvements, people are just not going to come. Because the biggest complaint we get from this place is we have nowhere to prepare our food or set food or anything like that. You know, so we're just doing put maybe a cabinet, a row, a bar or something, maybe a microwave. Sure, absolutely.
I'm not arguing with any of the items you had in there. About where the money's coming from, and if
you
can say that,
they're
just that set amount. So.
Sure.
Thank you, Nancy. Mr. Reynolds?
On the shelter house, it was in 2013, we made, it was like $11,900, something, almost $12,000. This definitely brings in some cash value to us. So I can't see, you know, we're getting 50% from the county. Yeah, that's totally fine with me.
And we lose a lot compared to the other shelters in the area have a kitchenette.
Yeah. I was shocked to see how many people have had Thanksgiving
in here before. I'm excited to see what we do.
I saw pictures on social media of someone who had a family Thanksgiving in here.
Yeah. It happens every year. I think the same person gets it every year.
It's actually pretty amazing. So.
It is.
All right. Any other? Mr. Lindsay.
Comment. Mrs. Lovanovich mentioned she wanted to know where the money was coming from. And correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Bridge or Ms. Harris. With the passage of the police levy, did that not free up some money this year?
Oh, absolutely.
From the general fund? So the general fund is a lot more healthier this year than it was last year.
Sure.
Is that not correct?
It shouldn't have freed up anything from that at all.
That's
my way of thinking.
Oh, no.
Now listen, because we were short that $200,000, right? So you didn't free up anything. You just replaced it with that.
What's
levy.
That? We were never short $200,000.
No. We were never short. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, but the cost of you got to understand, the general fund paid for the sheriff contract in years past. Okay? So it would be $250,000 one year, maybe $500,000. That money comes out of the general fund. Since the police levy was passed, now the police levy pays for it, so therefore the general fund does see a relief off that.
We never paid for it last year. We cut it out, remember? We didn't have the extra two deputies, so we weren't paying for.
We still had to pay for the two we had.
Right.
And that was the $250,000. Or something around that, I don't know.
You're saying that it freed up the general fund. I don't see it freeing anything up because you didn't pay for it.
We didn't get the two deputies for free.
Excuse me, Mr. Bridge. I think what she's talking about freeing the money up, because the city was in such bad shape last year when the council removed, did away with two of the deputies. That money went to sustain the city, you know, to pay the bills and stuff, so to speak. It really didn't save us any money. Am I correct on my thinking, ma'am?
You're correct. Plus, in the beginning of the fiscal year, we were in the negative on several funds in general, too. Mm-hmm. So we went into a really bad situation, and we needed everything we could, use, the general fund, the water, the sewer, Twin Creeks. So we have recovered this year well, and in the report, we did get a little more revenue in total for all the funds than we had anticipated a year ago when we made our budget. So that's all starting to help.
We didn't pay those people for how many months? So it wasn't anything that you had to be covered because we never paid it out.
We paid all of the police this year out of the general fund. Once we started. Okay, so I'm not sure how.
Mr. Reynolds has got a. Mr. Reynolds has got a comment.
I think I see what you're saying. So when we that $250,000 that we stopped using for the two deputies, that money that we had stopped using, ended up taking that $250,000, started paying the bills with that money. And so when we replaced that, so it's like taking from one person's pocket and saying, all right, now we got to pay for these instrumental items, whether it's salaries or. Repairs or car repairs or what have you. So the money wasn't freed up until this year because now the levy's coming in. And so that $250,000 that we had used to plug the holes is now back into the general fund. And we're not using that money anymore to plug the holes because now we have $500,000 more less there than coming in. Do you see what I'm saying?
You told me first then we couldn't have four deputies because we wouldn't have the money until later on. Now all of a sudden the money's there.
When we first got the quote for the four deputies, it was a lot higher than 2 years ago when we had the four deputies. So all we were doing at that point was wanting to be conservative, watch to see how much we were collecting before we commit to four deputies that maybe we would not have enough money again and get back in the same shape. But after they got the contract negotiated and the exact amounts, it was affordable and we moved forward with the four.
All right. Anyone else?
No,
good. Moving on. Any other questions from the audience? All right, Gene, we're going to go through the ordinances.
Mr.
Collier, sir. Mayor Lowry, tonight we have three introductions and three actions, and I'll go through three introductions. Ordinance 16-01, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 2-1-16. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract with Cintas for the purpose of maintaining clean roads at the wastewater treatment plant. Ordinance 16-02, introduction tonight, public hearing, action on 2-1-16. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to submit consent to the Ohio Department of Transportation for an overlay project located within the city of New Carlisle. Ordinance 16-03, introduction tonight, public hearing in action on 2-1-16. An ordinance establishing compensation rates for certain management personnel. Ordinance 16-04E, introduction tonight, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract for the purchase of a new police cruiser and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Mayor. Mr. Lowry.
Motion to adopt ordinance 16-04E.
Second.
I'm going to pick one.
Take your pick.
Yeah,
take
your Was
that you, Mr. Lindsay? Was it you and Jim?
It was both of us.
I heard you first.
Okay, I'll take it.
And just an explanation of this ordinance. We're going to buy a new police cruiser. I mean, that's exactly what it means. You know, we passed the police levy. Things had quickly changed when we got the 47-plus thousand reduction in the sheriff contract for this year. This was actually purchased, was supposed to be bought in 17, but we're just going to do it a year early because of the savings off the contract.
Okay. Mr. McLaughlin.
Did we not have a cruiser that just went down that we had been using?
Yes, yes.
So that's another reason that we need a cruiser, is that correct?
Sure.
Thank you.
Mr. Reynolds.
What cruiser did go down?
Or 2008 Dodge Charger.
Okay.
I think somebody asked this earlier, and I'm just going to ask it again, just for probably records. Moorfield's all paid off, mm-hmm. And is that cruiser running good? Is it running good? I heard that one of the cruisers was in a wreck. That's why I'm kind of getting at. So am I wrong? I just heard it. So.
No, I haven't heard. As a matter of fact, Moorfield used the dealer and used the OSP's maintenance guide for that cruiser, which is really expensive to do, but with that cruiser specific, we're going to maintain that program with a dealer till it expires under us.
Okay, thank you.
Did you hear one of our cruisers was in a wreck?
Yeah, about
$7,000 to repair this one.
Okay.
Did you hear it was in a wreck or was a wreck?
That could be it. Maybe that wasn't.
Facebook or somebody just tell you that face to face? Did you hear it on Facebook?
I overheard something.
Okay.
I just overheard.
It's not true.
And it could be not true. So.
I hope it's not. I've never, if it is, I've first heard. Yeah.
Mr. Bridge, on that, the price of that was what? It was $27,500 for the Ford Explorer?
For two of them that I had, that I got, are in stock. If for some reason they sell by tomorrow or whatever, we would have to look around, but the state bid price is a couple thousand less. These are specific ones that were ordered in with some options. It could be this exact cruiser, or it could be one similar.
Is that a little cheap? I mean, when I saw that, and the interceptor package, engine package, and everything, is that because
state bid? This is under the state term contract.
Okay.
Or anyone who meets that contract price.
Okay. Thank you.
Good deals.
Mr. Lindsay.
I have a question. They're going to be 2016 cruisers, correct? They're a cruiser?
Yes.
Okay, on the paperwork here, I was looking through on the far right side of the printout here. One of them has 2014 model year. Is that the package or is that something different? One has 2016 model year and one has 2014 model year.
Where are you seeing
It's on this here.
Yeah, you showed it to me.
It's over here.
Both sides, these 20.
No, the other side, right side. All the way to the right
two?
Side, Randy.
Well, he has two. One says 16, one says 14.
Yeah, both upper lefts are 2016, but both right sides, 116, 114.
Right.
That's probably a misprint.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure everything was new and not something stripped from another unit.
Yeah, I almost guarantee it to Ms. Brin, because I had to have him add other things to this to compare apples to apples.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Cobb.
Is that fully ready to be used?
Equipped.
We got to get it striped and put lights in it and the inside, something to do with back seats, right?
The whole equipment package that goes on it will be additional.
And if we're paying for that outright, we're just going to pay for that. That was included in the CIP.
Okay. Mr. Reynolds?
Does this car have the ability, because I know Bill McIntyre and I are really good fans, but this, like, of dash cams, the ability to have a dash cam put into it?
Yes.
Okay. Sergeant Underwood, how this is kind of a dumb question, but since it's going to have four-wheel drive, mm-hmm. and New Carlisle gets every type of weather there is, I mean, this is obviously going to be a big plus for anybody that's driving it, correct, especially in the winter?
Oh, absolutely. And we use four-wheel drive in the summer, too, to get back to places where a car couldn't get back to. We have several homes around the area that is extremely hard to get to.
Thank you, bike path.
Yeah, the bike path. Thank you, Chief. They're very useful.
Thank you, sir. Mr. McLaughlin.
The Sheriff's Department really is going to all SUVs now.
Yes, sir.
Going to, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
They're much roomier. Deputies like them a lot better. You don't have a problem with a bigger deputy getting in and out with all their equipment and so forth. So it's a much better utilized vehicle. Is that correct?
Right. They set a little higher, a little easier to see, more crash friendly, I guess.
Thank you.
Mr. Lindsay?
Sergeant Underwood, Ford Explorers are that type of vehicle. They also last a little longer, don't they? I mean, what's the life expectancy on a 2016 that's new? Would it, unless it got wrecked, I understand that, but would it be 3-4 years where it'd have to be replaced?
Well, our life expectancy in New Carlisle is never. We have one we've had over 10 years, so. No, that life expectancy is great on them. And well, the car I drove up here tonight from the sheriff's office just turned 120,000, so we'll get, if things work out right, we get the maintenance done timely and all that, I don't see any reason why we can't get 125,000 out of it.
Well, I'm hoping that the city will be in better financial straits to where we can turn cars a little quicker every 3-4 years, something like that, get a better trade-in, better resale value on them.
Hopefully, at some point in time, we can come up with a 5-year plan, follow that 5-year plan so we don't get in the situation we have the last 4 or 5 years.
And I believe you may be already working on that because you're proactive.
Maybe.
Thank you, sir.
Any other questions from council? Mr. Collier.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Absolutely.
Mr. Craybacher.
Yes.
Mayor Lowry.
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre.
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds.
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay.
Yes.
Pass 7-0. Ordinance 16-05E, introduction tonight, public hearing and action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a contract for engineering services for the Edgebrook Avenue Overlay Project and declaring an emergency.
Council?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. McLaughlin.
I move that we accept ordinance 16-05E.
Second.
And so an explanation of this ordinance, this is the Edgebrook Overlay that we briefly talked about earlier with some curbs and gutters. Thus money will be, the funds to pay for this will be used out of the street improvement levy. I will be getting signs made through Dayton Stencil that says your tax dollars at work, so people will see the signs and they'll realize their tax dollars are at work. This is a big project for the city. It's going to do the entire length of Edgebrook.
Yes.
So we'll notice a big difference on that.
Council, any questions?
Sir?
Mr. Lindsay.
I hate to keep asking questions, but you know, I'm kind of new at this game. The overlay that they're doing, can you explain that so I'll know what they're doing?
Absolutely.
Are they cutting blacktop off, or are they just putting like a thin skim down?
Basically, this is not where they dig up the whole road a foot deep and replace all new. This is taking the surfaces existing, and they use like a drum with teeth on it. They scratch it, so, and then they put 2 inches. Actually, I think it's this one we're estimating is going to be 2.5 inches of fresh asphalt on top of what's existing now, adjusting all manholes. As you know, on some edge road, they got manholes that really stick up. Mm-hmm. That, and then obviously a lot of the crumbling curb and gutter.
Okay.
I am looking to have a meeting with them on any of the citizens in, on that street that would like to, let's say it's not bad, but they want to replace anyway, do it during the project. So.
With them covering, right? Them covering it?
Yeah.
Talking about if they
Well, with them covering it outside of what we already have scoped out.
Okay. What about, do you have a projected start time on this?
And that is the reason we're doing it as emergency. I want to get it out for winter bidding to try and get one of these companies who really want some work and get some good bids. As you're aware, fuel prices are going down, which means asphalt prices go down, which hopefully means I can get this job and get another decent street job done later on this year in a different part of town.
Okay.
So, yes.
Thank you. Mr. Collins.
Mr. Lindsay.
Sir?
Mr. Lindsay?
Oh, yes, sorry.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugh?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passed 7-0. Ordinance 16-06E, introduction tonight, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into a modified contract for police protection with the Sheriff of Clark County, Ohio, and declaring an emergency.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. McLaughlin.
Ordinance 1606E, if you would please, we'd like to
move forward with that. Thank you, sir.
Second.
I'm trying to get the verbiage.
I was waiting.
It's been a while.
Age. You got to track it.
I'm out of practice.
You made that second.
I did.
Craybaugher.
And an explanation of this ordinance just gives me the ability to sign the amended contract. I do believe I attached the email under this one as well that you guys that hopefully you've read it. They didn't change the numbers on the back cover. They did change the language within the body of the contract to state when we get billed and that we would only get billed for what we actually use. Their logic with not changing the numbers on the back that is maybe 4 months down the road we get two new deputies, they have a different pay scale than the two we have in place, then we have to go back and amend it all over again. So this is their final product. This is what we have to sign. The prior agreement that was passed by ordinance, I had them mail me a copy that says void on it, so that is stuck with that one. I wasn't going to sign that and have them sign off on it before we go to this end, just to and hopefully avoid any confusion with that. So, other one's void, this one now stands, but again, the body of the language states that we will be billed at the end of each month and only be billed for what we used.
Thanks, sir.
Just to clear that up a little bit, we're still saving money on this contract. Basically, I think we were told it's between $30,000 and $40,000 less than what we were paying previously. $47,000 less than what we paid before. Is that correct?
That is correct.
But it may be adjusted during the year if deputies are changed.
If deputies are changed now, we get a higher tier paid deputy, or definitely, or even our current deputies switch insurance plans. We can't control that.
Right.
So we have to accumulate that cost. That's why it says in the body of this contract, it says there's a maximum amount that won't go over, and that is the what they call the worst case scenario, the highest salaries and also the highest insurance.
I want to thank you for looking into that and getting that savings for us.
Sure.
Council.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Lindsay.
He's been waiting.
Go right
ahead. So based on the new contract, and since we have four basically low, the lower wage scale of the deputies, off of the the figures we had for $330,000, we should save approximately another 10 grand off of that. Would that be correct?
What figures are you looking at?
I'm looking at something you handed us, you gave us last meeting.
He's looking at the chart.
I have a copier if you'd like to see it.
Yeah, let me refresh it.
Look at that chart.
I'd like to have it back, however. Because the one that you put in our packet, it has the deputies, the four deputies at the high end of that scale. That one you're looking at has the three deputies at the current scale that they are at, plus a high end, but the new deputy, he's not going to be at $58,000.
I don't know what his pay grade is.
He's a new deputy, I mean.
You're right, that fourth column is the question mark column on this one.
Right.
So Lindsay, moving
right
forward. We don't know what that tier is going to be, and I don't know what insurance plan the gentleman has. He could have a single, he can have a single plus one, or he can have a family. So we can expect it. I can't do numbers in my head. This guy over here will tell you I'm horrible at doing math in my head. But for example, if it's the same, if he gets $46,000 a year on salary, we're going to see a reduction on this of at least 12, just based off salary.
Right.
And he's at the high end of the insurance. So we can either see an additional savings of around $5,000 to $6,000, or an additional savings of maybe $10,000 to $11,000, depending again on what insurance plan he has.
Right.
Sure. Now, with that being said, all three of these stay the same, and this gentleman is the highest of all this. That's what we're going to pay for insurance, for sheriff funds.
Can I ask the sergeant a question then?
Yeah,
do you know what his pay scale is? The new deputy, what was his name?
Boswell.
Deputy Boswell, yes.
No, I do not. Need to check in for that. On that,
I mean, just ballpark, he's only been at the sheriff's office 5 years.
He's
he wouldn't be at 58 grand, would he?
He's probably getting ready to top out.
At 58?
That might explain it.
I'm not sure what the top number is. I don't
we'll have a
lot
better understanding when we get that profile.
Okay.
Sure.
Thank you.
Mr. McIntyre.
I have the same level of confusion here. One of the things on this, and I'm sure there's an easy answer for this, on the breakout you see here, when it's listed for salary across all four, it's the highest salary, the highest step, the highest whatever it is. And I know in the email listed, it says the maximum amount you see in the contract is a legal necessity. So I understand why, per the contract, we'd have to put in, you know, whatever, legal necessity, I get that. The thing is, are we approving the amount for each deputy to make the highest step? Because with the cost saving, we're lower.
We have no say in that. We have no say. If somebody comes in and bid out, and correct me if I'm wrong, sir, sorry.
Yes.
But if say one of our two, all right, and they have to open up the bidding on their end, we can't say we don't want you because you get paid
sure
too much.
So what would happen, therefore, is we approve the amount for the highest step, and at the same time, we're not going to be paying for the highest step, so there'll be money left over in the account because of the savings. Is that correct?
It could be.
Yes, and there's multiple ways you can say it.
If they all were a lower step.
The key to this contract, what you need to look at is how we get billed and when we get billed. That's the key. This right here might be your worst-case scenario.
Sure.
If we start fresh and get all four new deputies and they all make this much money, top tier, and they all got a family plan, that's what we're going to get, which is the 396.
So legally we have to do that?
Well, according to them, legally we have to do
according
that
to them, I'm sure, yes.
Yeah, I didn't like it if you got shot okay in the email that I sent you.
According to them, what about what did our attorney have to say?
Our attorney agreed with them.
Okay, just double-checking.
She did. And I understand both sides. My concern was, I want the numbers changed because it looks better, but then they changed the language. But again, it's to the point that if mid-year we get three new deputies, we don't want to have to sit and go through all this legislation again. Because it's not just us that has to pass this, and then it goes all through the county who, well, Lord knows how long that would take. So I get what they're saying. Again, focus on how we get billed and what we're getting billed for.
So my question is on the last contract, why were they at different? Why were there different numbers except for the fourth deputy? They were in the $47,000 range, the one that we had approved in the special meeting.
No, you did not approve one in the special meeting. That had
in the special meeting that we had voted for, there was a
No, that was a thing that I made for you to give you a rough estimate of how much we would save.
But there was a pat inside our ordinance or inside the contract.
Yeah, again, I put it in there.
Okay, so when we were voting off that, we didn't have the full information.
You know, you had
well,
this.
We said that it was going to be, well, we said, not to argue with you, but we said that sure. This was going to be the 47,000, this was going to be so-and-so. I mean, that was, when I voted for it, I was under the impression that was going to be the set-in price. And it will be, but the problem is that this is concerning because it's 58,000 for each of these deputies. I know this is the absolute worst case scenario, but now the question is in the past, have we paid that 58,000 just because it was in the contract?
Quite frankly, I hate to say it like this,
yes,
but
we did.
So, I don't know. But here's the deal. Okay. You signed the contract. It's null and void. Even if you did overpay, you're not going to get reimbursed. You signed the contract.
Well, I think that it's bad for the
sheriff. I hate to point fingers here, but...
Okay, well, I think it's bad for the sheriff to say, here you go, vote for this. This is the number that you need. Oh, by the way, thanks for giving us the extra $10,000 for each deputy while we're sitting here in 2014 losing cops. I think it's a terrible, terrible form for the sheriff. I mean, yes, we signed it because we were going off the information that we had present. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you give someone information, say, vote for this, and you only get, you know, one page of a two-page piece of paper, you're like, okay, well, this sounds great. And then on the back side, they're like, oh, wait, there's some invisible ink here. We just overpaid for God knows how long. Well, say it's $10,000 the last 10 years.
One simple question a lot of people could have asked themselves. How much do you get paid an hour? It's all took.
Well, that's why we count on our legal team to say, is this correct? I mean, none of us are attorneys here. Am I right? I mean...
Yeah, I'm not an attorney.
Oh, that's what I'm saying. But the problem is the attorney looks over this contract to make sure that we've been getting a fair fix. You know, maybe Lilinette did a good job this time.
Your city attorney will look over the form to make sure it's legal. Your city attorney's not looking over to make sure you get paid a fair amount. That goes back to your city manager and your council. So not the attorney, she's just looking over to make sure it's legally formed.
Okay, well that's a good point. But so we got rid of the last city manager sure. And city attorney. So I think that sums it up. You know, just think about how much it was about 10,000 for deputies. You go, let's say 2007, roughly. You know, you're looking at two deputies that we didn't have to probably didn't have to cut. So we've been getting hosed.
Mr. Reynolds, that's not exactly true because we don't know what the pay scale was for the deputies we've had previously. Some of them were at the higher scale.
Oh, I understand.
Quite a few
that.
Of them were.
But not every one of them were, I can tell you that.
Maybe not
so
every
we
one.
Got over, so
but
the
we
point
don't
is,
know the answer to
we still were overcharged. That's the point. The point being, we were overcharged. The sheriff knew it. We didn't know. And now we're out of the money, and we had to cut our deputies last year in dire straits.
Well, there might be some law in Ohio that says he's allowed to do it like that. So maybe I need to do a little research, maybe contact Montgomery County and find out the cities who contract out with their sheriff. There's still a lot of unanswered questions, but again, it's how much do you want to invest in finding these answers when you're not going to get any return on them, you know? And then two, if we have quote unquote overpaid, they're not charging us for other aspects. So they're not charging them to schedule they're not charging us for all the free services we get. So I'm sure there'll be some sort of discussion that say if we overpaid, they're going to sit there and say, well, you didn't get charged for this. So is it a moot point? Moving forward, this is what we're about to work with. You know, we can be a little more cognizant together as a team about how much we're going to pay, you know, but to harp on the past, and I get everybody's concern, but the bottom line is a legal document is signed.
Mr. Lowry.
Thank you. I have a couple questions that I would like to have answered either from you or Sergeant Underwood before I can vote on that. And one, I've talked to you before, Randy, and I need somebody's word because it's not in here, and I trust you. That is about the hours that New Carlisle and you have some say-so on the hours. Because I know in the past, there was no cruisers on the street when the kids was coming out, going, and coming from school. Sheriff Kelly didn't seem to care about that. He was not concerned, okay?
I think with a four deputy schedule, I think it would be normal shift hours.
Okay. But I want to know if you have some say so in the house.
I have
some. Him
I do have some
say
over that.
I think you're wrong. We need a deputy here for this time. You can make that happen.
Sure, I'll take my opinion into consideration.
Because he doesn't live here, we do.
Sure, but he's also the sheriff of Clark County.
I'll leave that one there.
I didn't have to
say
that one.
I'll just leave it here, and you know what.
Sure.
And Mr. Underwood, certainly. Second thing, what is your title, Mr. Underwood?
Pardon?
What is your title?
My title?
Your sergeant, but in this whole scheme of things that you go back and forth and all the work that you do and don't get a whole lot of credit for, your superiors?
I'm a sergeant for the Clark County Sheriff's Office in the Community Education Division, and I'm acting sergeant in New Carlisle. As you could change it, say I'm the police administrator, but.
And that's what I was thinking, police administrator. Is he going to be here for the duration of his contract?
As far as I'm concerned, he is.
What if Mr. Kelly decides?
No, the contract says we both mutually agree upon it.
Okay, and I would hope that you would not agree to anything Gene Kelly said about taking him right here.
I don't see why.
Because Robert was an outstanding job. I mean, you know, and I sit here and I'm sorry, guys, I'm going to tell you what's on my mind. I watched Gene Kelly sit right over here and throw that man under the bus, saying his job was not that significant. That was a bunch of bull. Okay? And we all heard that. Okay. And that is kind of upset.
Good. Sure.
Last but not least, the sick leave. If a deputy gets sick, he has to take off. It'll be 10 days before he's replaced, okay? Mm-hmm. Worst case scenario, you have four deputies. Three of them get sick. One gives the other one the flu. All three of them off. Now, I would hope that the sheriff would step in and say, well, we're not going to stop the sheriff and make you go 10 days with only one deputy in town. Okay? So I think that needs to be talked about. I mean, that could happen, you know. It's,
I think it could. I think it's very slim, but
well, I do too.
I think it could.
If it did, I, you know,
I don't think at the end of the day,
saying, hey, giving you know, it, here it is, you only got one deputy to live with.
I don't think Sheriff Kelly's going to put the city at risk like that, given what time of year it is.
Okay.
Very well said, Mr. Bridge. Mr. Mayor.
I'm not. Thank you.
Mr. Lindsay.
Mr. Bridge.
Yes, sir.
On the police contract, apparently some of us has read that contract. There's one statement in there that says that we would only pay and be billed for the exact amount that the deputies cost us in any given month. Will that statement supersede this? Because I really don't want to pay a new deputy $58,000 a year on the salary, let alone all the other stuff that comes up to $99,000 a year. The three deputies, two current deputies we have, one's at, I think, 47, I think the other one's at 46, if I remember, from the paper that I handed you. So that would basically supersede this $58,000 salary, correct?
The numbers you have for any of the worst case scenario, so nothing's going to go above that. Okay, so anything below that is a win for the city.
Money in our pocket.
It's money in our pocket. Now, again, we can't control what deputies we get. We can't control how much they get paid, nor can we control what insurance plan they have.
Oh, I understand that.
So
that's all done through their contract.
So 2 months down the road, if we get a new deputy, and they get they're at the high end of everything, our new invoice at the end of the month is going to reflect that.
Okay.
But again, we can't control that.
But I have to share my concern with Mr. Lowry, and I don't think it would really happen, but if all four of our deputies or three of our deputies got sick and we're left with one deputy, mm-hmm. then our citizens has to wait 20, 30 minutes for a Clark County deputy from wherever they're at in the county to show up for their call.
Okay. My understanding of it, that's been in the contract for as far back as I can see. How many times has that actually happened? And I understand your concern.
It has happened.
How many times and when?
One time we had two deputies off and he did wait to 10 days to replace them.
If it happens.
Sergeant, is that in your union some way?
If it happens one time, it's 2 minutes, I think.
10 days off and you got to replace it. Is that part of your union negotiation?
I think that's part of it.
Nobody can change, or is that something the sheriff would put in there?
I don't believe that's a contract issue. What is a contract issue is who comes out.
Yes.
So let's say the council up here, we're going to come out to road patrol. And Mr. Lowry decided he wasn't going to. He didn't want to, wanted to stay where he was at. He could, then they moved to the next senior person. Mr. McLaughlin said, well, yeah, I want to work the road. So regardless of how much time he has, if he's lined up in seniority to be the next person, then he would be the person coming in. So you might bypass two or three deputies before you get someone that comes out. And it's an option for the deputy. You can stay in the jail or you can come out. It's a different environment, different job. We are giving them the best training right now that you can give. We're taking extra time with those coming up to Duke Law. And then we're going to give them more training when they get up here. Make sure to know the area, citizens in the area. So they are getting good training, but it is a contract issue on which deputy comes out. And you know, it's hard to tell who has a family and who doesn't, and what type of insurance they're going to have. If you look at it like this is the minimum we're going to pay and this is the maximum we're going to pay, it might help you out some. So you know, if we have four deputies in step four, you're going to pay less than four deputies. I think it's step six, maybe nine now, step nine. So you got a minimum you're going to pay and a maximum you can pay. And everything else will fall in between.
And correct me if I'm wrong, the deputies we have, they're here to stay. And the only way they can be moved, if they want to move themselves, from my understanding, talking to one of them. It
would be difficult for them to move right now. There would have to be a position open up, or they would have to mutually have an agreement with someone else, mm-hmm. and that would have to be approved before that could even happen.
But if they leave, it's because they want to.
Yeah, they just can't go up and say, well, I'm tired of it for a while, I don't want to work there anymore. They can't do that.
Yeah. All right. Anyone else? Mr. Collier, call for the vote, please.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybaugh?
Yes.
Pass 7-0.
Items Mayor, if I may, just one more thing. Watch what's being paid each month. You see the check that's paid out to the Sheriff's Department. You can track that exactly by that. So each month that we get the readout of the checks, you'll know what's being paid to the Sheriff's Department.
This
so
time.
Watch that as we go along.
I would also think that the deputies, because the two deputies, the two ladies we have, they both came from the jail, did they not, Sergeant?
Everyone starts out in the jail.
Okay. So I would assume there's nobody in the jail, unless they just don't want to ever come out, you know, from the jail. They're not making that $58,000 a year salary. Would that be a good assumption, you think, sir?
No, a deputy's a deputy. They'll be making the same salary in the jail as the road, depending on their staff.
So the road doesn't pay them more than the jail?
No, sir.
Well, thank you. My information was wrong, and I will have a conversation.
Mr. Collier, you want to run down the list of other business, please?
Yes, Mayor. City offices will be closed on Monday, February the 15th, for President's Day. The next Crime Watch meeting will be Wednesday, February the 10th, 2016 at 6:30 p.m. here at Smith Park Shelter House. Community events, our joint government meeting will be Monday, February the 29th at 6:30 p.m. here at Smith Park Shelter House, and that's hosted by New Prague City Council. And that is open to the public. And also, as a reminder, New Cross City Council will hold its annual town hall meeting on Monday, 3/21/16. Council meeting will start at 6:30 p.m. The town hall meeting immediately following that meeting. And am I safe to say that meeting will be somewhat abbreviated, but we'll cover some of the same stuff in the town hall meeting. So it's really going to be late by the time. So I hope not.
Does everybody like how it was done before? I mean, how it was presented, did anybody recommend any changes to the town hall meeting? This is the first one I've been doing, so I'm just going to be reading from the start.
We've had a town hall meeting in the past that we've had a lot of people there because it was a very large controversy about it. Trying to put a cemetery in the city at one time. But other than that, they've been
pretty mellow.
Any other business from council?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Reynolds?
I know that Mr. McIntyre and I have been speaking about this for quite a while. I would definitely think it'd be important to, if I don't know if this might take a motion, you'll have to correct me, Gene, to ask the state treasurer's office to come in here to go through their online checkbook. It's a free service they offer. We've been talking about this for quite a while, and I think it's something that we definitely should contact the treasurer's office to have them come in to explain what it is to ourselves and our citizens and possibly join it. You know, a bunch of entities are doing it. I think it's a good idea.
What kind of manpower does that require? We're very short staffed. I'm not shooting it down by any means, but...
Well, that's a question for that. That's a question. That's why I think we should have them come and discuss this. I mean, I know it's a simple email, but you send it to them, and they do all the data work. I know that, but I don't know.
You wouldn't need a motion for that. That would just be something you would ask the city manager to do.
Okay, I just wanted to schedule.
Can you email me who I need to contact?
Yeah, I'll do that fine. Thanks.
I've already had one meeting, and the other one is with the representative to intro. But there was some other communities that I've talked to that were working out some bugs, and I wasn't ready to jump in yet.
Right.
But we have another appointment scheduled after budget to review it again, because it is a little time-consuming, and I don't have the time on my plate right now.
Right.
So whenever everybody wants to do it, I just suggest after budget time.
Oh, that's fine. I mean, I definitely know you're slammed right now. Let's get ready to be the end of the school year, so no worries.
Okay.
Just sooner rather than later.
Council, any members from audience?
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Reynolds.
Move that we adjourn.
A second.
Did it have to happen?